by 2013, 14, you began to see this methamphetamine marching across the country. By 2016 and 17, it's in the Midwest, in Ohio, and which never saw Mexican methamphetamine before that. And by 2019, it's up in the New England area, which never had meth of any kind before that. And so it's knocking the price down by 80, 90%. It's just a remarkable, unprecedented example of the underworld providing one kind of drug in just mass quantities. The problem with the drug is, though, that unlike the ephedrine drug, it's unlike it in this way. The ephedrine drug was a party drug. It was a euphoric thing. You began to kind of feel like you wanted to hang out and party all night long and talk with people and be around other folks and this kind of thing. It was big in the gay community. It was big all over, really. That was what people used it for. This form of methamphetamine is the opposite. It's a very sinister thing. It takes you inside, and it's accompanied by very rapid, my reporting has shown anyway, very rapid onset symptoms of schizophrenia, paranoia, horrible paranoia, horrible hallucinations, very terrifying. You can't live in a house. You can't live really with other people. So very quickly, people go homeless. And of course, they can't live in homeless shelters either, because they're surrounded by people they think are after them. And it's a horrible mental illness, meth-induced mental illness that ensues. And that is why also we have, I think, a main driver of our tent encampment homeless is this methamphetamine that in colossal quantities has marched across the United States over the last 8 years.
A very familiar paradox here, it seems to me, that just as when the feds decided that, oh, we have this opioid epidemic, let's cut off the opioid drugs, people went to heroin, and then from heroin to fentanyl. In other words, the intent that when the government moves to stop a particular chemical, instead of stopping the actual drug itself, it forces a move into another thing. So getting rid of ephedrine, cutting down that, led to them to innovate this different kind of meth that from different chemicals that turned out to be worse. It's sort of a whack-a-mole in a way that you can try and ban some kind of chemical, but they will figure out a way to replicate it. The one question I have with you on that is that didn't the meth users notice the difference? I mean, did suddenly that one week they're getting
sure,
ephedrine
meth? Very quickly.
So tell me how that happened.
Yes, I would say that I think a lot of these guys, the guy I first spoke to about this, who clued me into this, was a guy named Eric Barrera, who at the time I met him, had been sober, off meth for several years, was now a homeless outreach coordinator. And he told me when I met him one night that immediately he noticed the difference. But it's highly addictive as well. It's a strange thing because it's very sinister. It sent him into a violent paranoia. He was stabbing the walls. This is a very peaceful fella, and stabbing the walls of his girlfriend's house, thinking there's a man. She's hiding a man in the walls, and never had this ever happened. He'd been using meth for 8 years by then. He said, never had this ever happened. There was no more euphoria. I just kind of crawled into myself. And it's that part of methamphetamine which I think keeps people using. It's scary. It's damaging. But the other thing about this meth is that I think once it turns you, you know, and once it creates or once the symptoms of mental illness occur in you and you are now homeless, it is a drug that also separates you from so severely from reality that it actually makes it easy to be homeless. You know, it creates homelessness and then makes homelessness worth bearing because you don't really know where you are. You don't know where you've been. I've talked to people who said, I just kind of lost a week. I'm not really sure what happened, you know, when I was using this stuff. And so the euphoria is gone, but there's still this thing that keeps you using because you're so, it seems to me anyway, so involved in your own thoughts. And you don't want to be around other people at all. And this allows you to just be on your own by yourself, sometimes watching pornography, just in your tent. Maybe the tents work perfectly for that. You know, the tents are like this perfect housing vehicle. All you have to do to get away from this menacing, scary world is crawl inside a tent, and you're all alone with whatever strange thoughts your brain is cooking up.